Welcome and please be seated. It's really great to see such a full hall at the Valedictory Symposium. Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends and family of Professor Bartha Iommi, a warm welcome to our Blauwe Zaal where we have this Valedictory lecture. Many of you have been here today already at the symposium that you've had, state-of-the-art in medical imaging analysis earlier today. And others are here for the first time in the Blauwe Zaal for the valedictory lecture. And it's an honor and pleasure for me to say a few words of welcome to you all, and Bart in particular. Professor Taha Omni started his scientific career at the Delft University of Technology. In 1978, he obtained his master's degree in biological physics, with a remarkable result at that time. He managed to develop an eye movement-driven typewriter for paralyzed patients, and the patients could reach up to 180 characters per minute. And that was almost 40 years ago. And you can imagine that, given the circumstances under those in those days, a really remarkable achievement. He later on obtained his doctoral degree in 1983 at the University of Utrecht, with his thesis on the behavior of motor units in upper arm muscles, very much in biology at that time. And I still very much remember that Bart was for the first time here at the university, where we were basically recruiting you as a full professor. And we were very lucky that in 2001 you joined us as one of the first professors in biomedical engineering. And so of that time, you've been a professor of biomedical image analysis. Bartha Iommi has served as president of the Dutch Association of Clinical Physics, the Association of Biophysics and Biomedical Technology, and the Dutch Society of Pattern Recognition and Image Processing. And next to a number of academic positions in China and Taiwan, where he was very active during his years at this university, and every step of that you've taken in that sense, he's also a senior member of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers and a fellow of the European Alliance for Medical and Biological Engineering and Science. Bart has supervised 30 PhD theses, including 6 cum laudes, and over 140 master theses. He has published over 220 papers, 12 books and book chapters, and he holds 2 patents. He's a frequently awarded teacher and has received the Mathematica Innovation Award and the Friendship Award of, I hope I pronounced that right, Laojing province in China. His academic achievements have contributed to the development of numerous medical applications, such as in breast cancer detection, cardiac motion and modeling, lung cancer detection, interventional radiology and radiotherapy. A very broad spectrum in what he has done. In this lecture, the valedictory lecture, Vision for Health, he will be talking about his inspiration by biological vision. That's the one thing that you've been working on for quite a few years, and you're very passionate about that. And his quest to develop robust algorithms for quantitative medical image analysis. He will be showing the amazing abilities that we have to see inside our own brains, thanks to the research that he has been doing. And you will be hearing about his passion for working with students, nurturing and challenging to become world-class scientists. And quite a few of them are in the audience. It's really great to see so many of you here. And at the same time, he was creating a perfect atmosphere for collaborative teamwork. I'm also personally very grateful to have been able to work with you for 16 years, not only as a rector of the university, but also as one of your colleagues in the Department of Biomedical Engineering. It was a true pleasure to work with you. You're always full of energy, enthusiasm, and great ideas. And among the many things I will never forget is how easy you could shift between sleeping in a 5-star hotel in China and go backpacking in a domestic hotel and eat whatever food was going to be served for you. But the floor is yours.
Vision for Health, it actually says it all. It's about vision and it's about health. And what I go do in this lecture, now retiring and getting some older, is looking back a little bit and looking forward a little bit. I go talk about my profession. And my profession is about medical image analysis. And not only we have medical images everywhere, we have, I counted once, more than 26 different modalities. That means MRI, CT, PET, SPECT, etc. But about what can we do, how can we let the computer help to do all this? You see all these ellipsoids, registration, segmentation, modeling. In the symposium today, we saw many examples of it. But to the upper right, you see computer-aided diagnosis. That's the holy grail. Can the computer be just as good as us? And that has been my driving force. There is one computer that is just as good as us. That is our own computer. That's the brain. Can we mimic the brain mathematically, physically, in computer science and build it? And that whole field is called medical image computing or brain-inspired computing. And I'm going to talk a little bit about my passion in that field. So the classical way is computer-aided diagnosis in a pipeline of processes. The upper right, you see pre-processing, segmentation, feature extraction. What does it mean, feature extraction? There are a lot of features, landmarks, edges, corners, and so on, small things in images. And we need to find them by computer, and these are actually the primitives, like letters on the page. And if you find all these features, you have to group these features, and you put these features, after you have, in the lower left, you see the feature filters, and there are lots and lots of different filters have been thought after. You put them in a feature space. It's typically a very high-dimensional space. We call it the feature space. And then we have clustering techniques to find the clusters and say, okay, this is a benign tumor, that is this kind of texture. And then, of course, at the end, you need to see, is it working? What is the validation? And you always compare with human experts or a team of human experts, and then you compare the computer output with the expert output. And the curve that you do that is the ROC curve. And the more the curve, the corner of the curve is to the upper left in the image, the better it is. We did a lot of applications. When I came here, we had the wonderful situation that Philips was around the corner. Philips is the biggest in the Netherlands, and having on bicycle distance for my students such a fantastic lab, we started doing lots of applications there. One example is with the group of the late Professor Frans Gerritsen. He passed away far too early, but he had the group Easy Vision, and we had a wonderful collaboration with him, shared workstations, shared software, and we did, for example, virtual endoscopy. Anna Villanova, we'll talk about her later, she just did a PhD on that. And what is virtual endoscopy? You go search for polyps in the intestines. And you can go with a camera inside, but we have 9 meters of intestines. It's not so easy. It was just discovered that you can also do this by letting the patients not eat and drink for several days, blow up the intestines with CO2, and then make a high-resolution CT scan, and then make a fly-through and detect them automatically. And in the lower left, you see the red detections, and that is actually still working on any workstation. And to the right, you see the work of one of our first PhD students, finding occlusions in the incredible many emboli, of the pulmonary emboli, that means occlusions in the lungs. How can you find them? Well, we have to find them by small shape changes. As Professor Baines already said, we also worked on breast cancer detection. And this was also a collaboration with Philips. They discovered something new. Actually, it was discovered in the United States, but it was expanded into a workstation application. Quantitative dynamic contrast enhanced MRI of the breast. Well, what does it mean? You actually take a movie with MRI. So you take every 3 seconds or so, you take an MRI, and then you give some contrast injection, and you study how fast is the contrast moving. And if the contrast is in a tumor, you see that it is actually moving much faster. So if I use my mouse, I think I can. Can you see my mouse? No? I have two screens, it's difficult. In the lower, maybe I can use my. Yes, this should be better. You see, this is time. The contrast enhances, and if it is benign, it goes very slow. This may be suspicious, but if it is very fastly washed out, it's malignant. And why is that? In tumor, you have very strange new formation of capillaries. It's called angiogenesis. And these are very badly organized capillaries. They're way too fast built, so they're leaky. And these vessels, they make that the blood and the contrast medium, they flush much more easy. So we could now nicely depict all these voxels in the breast that were highly likely to have the MRI, to have the tumor there. But we have a big change in our field. And the change is called deep learning. Everybody has heard about deep learning because it is now everywhere. We have big data, we have fantastic, powerful machines, and we have new network technologies coming from artificial intelligence. And we used to have artificial intelligence with a couple of layers, three, four layers, and actually it never worked. We had 20 years or so that people tried to make these artificial networks. And now, since about 2012, people said, hey, if you make 20 layers, 40 layers, or maybe 100 layers, that works much better. And that's why it's called deep. We have so many more layers now. And these layers, you see it on the bottom, they were used for a very famous competition. There was a competition that was called ImageNet. They had 1.4 million images, all downloaded from Google. And people said, can you recognize these images by the content? Can you see if it's a dog, or a house, or a horse? And people were always 84%, 85%, and networks were better. And every year there was a big competition. And then one year, 10% better than everybody else. That was AlexNet. And everybody was astonished. That was a deep learning network. So then it was actually going like crazy. We see now deep learning in so many areas. But it looks like very much like the visual system. And I've spent, you can easily say, my whole life in what can we learn from this visual system. And the visual system is also a deep neural network. We have the retina here, and then it goes to layer one, to layer two, layer three, layer four. We have many layers in the visual system, and the visual system is huge. If I put my hand on the back of my head, it's about a quarter of my brain. A quarter of my brain is for vision. That means hundreds of millions of cells. And all these cells do convolutions. But why do we need hundreds of millions of cells? I go talk a little bit in my talk what is hidden here, about the mathematics of this, and go step by step, what do we see actually here? What happens in these layers? So these layers, they begin simple features, more complex, etc. And at the end, they take a decision. And whatever you put in there, it says, it's a cat. From the eyes, it goes here. And this part here is our visual system, layers V1, primary visual system, etc. So we know a little bit what is the visual system. And the results are actually quite amazing. To the left, we see a result from the lab of Bram van Ginneke, one of the speakers in the symposium, and now leading the top group in the Netherlands, one of the top groups in deep learning. Tens of PhD students are working. Here now, for example, pulmonary lung cancer, pulmonary nodules, very difficult to discriminate. Sometimes they're next to blood vessels and so on. But the deep learning system can give a very nice grading from red, orange to green, like a stoplight. But it even goes further. I was in Porto with the VIP Image conference with we saw with Professor Aurelio Campillo, who is also here today, that if you have noisy images like this, and you have many of them, you can actually learn from these systems how they actually should be. If you give them high quality images and you learn the low quality image, the network finally can make these high quality images just by doing deep learning. So if we can improve this type of image to this, so it is an amazingly attractive area. But how does it work? And the big thing today is that actually we don't know how it works. It's by far still a black box. So I'm going to talk a little bit what is discovered nowadays in this black box and talk about my passion, how we relate human vision, deep learning to this is the holy grail. Can we put it in a computer, give the computer to a company, and the company makes a product that all the doctors can use? If we have that, we have access to screening in high volume. We can have radiologists who can do all the nasty tasks that take a lot of time much easier. But I first go talk a little bit about my own journey. Professor Baeyens gave already a little bit of an insight. I started with some typewriter. I will do this quite quickly. But an amazing step for me was to go to Berkeley, and I spent there 4 months with Professor Larry Stark. I heard him here in Eindhoven, and he was talking about eye movements, a very inspirational guy. And I said, I want to do my project with you in my master phase. I arranged some money, and I went there, and I was ending up in the Bay Area vision community. It was a thriving community of vision scientists. I built this setup for pupil research, a fascinating time, but actually, that's how it began. I had to do my military service, and there I got introduced to remote sensing, because there I was in the Navy, and I had to design a scanner for finding with infrared drowned people in the sea, and we designed lots of things, helicopter flights. It was an amazing time, but it was my introduction to remote sensing. Then my PhD and time in Utrecht, I will quickly go, because many have touched on this already in the symposium. But I got deeply involved into neuroscience by putting needles in my own wires and building a whole setup. And I was inspired by many visionary people I want to show here. Professor Koenderink was head of the physics of man, and he was doing the first mathematics on vision. He said it's differential geometry, it's a differential engine. And we take derivatives, and we have all kind of feedback loops. We do optic flow, we do texture analysis. And I was fascinated by the fact that it was physics. It was really nice. It was not psychophysics and doing some measurements. No, it was really basic stuff. Professor Peiser, head of the largest imaging group at that time in the United States, he went for a year to Professor Peiser to learn about all these mathematics. And he was quite instrumental. We became big friends. And he donated his full image processing software to me in Eindhoven. Professor Van Waas, very visionary radiologist, ahead of his time. You see him here with 3D printing. And this was, I think, 30, 35 years ago. And Professor Max Viergeef, very visionary. He established the Image Sciences Institute into the large institute we have now. So all this was actually the beginning. There was no better place to learn all about this than as a physicist of the department. I was a clinical physicist, also for some time the chairman of this clinical physics society, and we got the first PhD students. I cannot mention everyone, but I do my best to mention this. We got a theoretical physicist, Luc Florac, Karel Zuiderveld doing 3D visualization, Veronese, image computing, Bram van Ginneke, and they all shaped my life. And then I went to Eindhoven. And in Eindhoven, I started from scratch. There was a new department, and it was quite an excitement department. And because we started from scratch, we could build up the situation like we had, and I feel still very much obliged that the freedom I found here in Eindhoven was exceptional. So we could build up a really nice team. You see my PhD students here, and this is, I think, many, so not all, are here today, and I feel very proud to have this really rich set of people seeing going their way, many in medical image analysis. But let's go to the brain. Front-end vision. And all the people who took my course, they've seen this image many times, but for those who see it for the first time, the brain is extremely well organized. The layer one here, you see here, every cell here has its perfect position. Not a single cell is on the right, is on the wrong place. Neighbor cells here are neighboring cells in the retina. It goes to the thalamus here, and it goes to the V1 primary cortex. And if you stick a cell, a needle in one of these cells, you do like this, what do you think this cell is actually seeing in the outside world? It's not seeing a pixel, but it's seeing a very small filter. And the filter looks like this. And if you see these filters, they were discovered by Hubel and Wiesel. They got the Nobel Prize. It was already quite some time ago. And these filters are actually the derivative filters. So you see the first derivative in X, in Y, very high order derivative filters. Small, bigger, larger. So we talk about multi-scale. And today we have all these deep neural networks. So here we have the input, the first layer, the second, and so on, and the output layer. And if you visualize what these networks do, you see many, many, many connections here. That's actually the way you model in a computer mathematically the synaptic connections. You train the model by putting an input here. You test if the output is right. If the output is not right, you propagate the error backwards by adjusting all these networks. It's called error back propagation. And you do this 100,000 of times. So you adjust all these network settings. So training is a big thing. But finally, you're ready. And you see that in the first layer, we have these simple filters, and they're exactly the filters like this. So in the first layer, we do already something that we did for some years. These are all the mathematical ones. These are the learned ones. And it turns out if you learn from specific data, you get specific filters. So this set is the first special set. We will go step by step through the other sets as well. So what we went to do is differential multi-scale differential geometry. We had a very nice international community. I started a series of multi-scale conferences. They are later matched into scale space and variational methods. This was the first team in 97, and many people have been very active in this area. And every 2 years, we had this meeting. It was fantastic. I could wrote quite... this book was a book on non-linear scale space. This was the proceedings of this first one. And this was a meeting I organized together with Professor Brookstein, one of the speakers of the symposium, in En Gedi in Israel. So what did we do with all these derivatives? Well, the first one was to find cardiac motion in a complete non-invasive way. Because if you measure the heart, you have to do X-ray. Well, X-ray is damaging. You can get cancer from the radiation. You have to put in catheters and do injection of contrast media. But this is a complete 4D MRI technique. So actually, you make a block of MRI 25 times per second, and you do it with structured light. So this is called tagging MRI. And you make a sinusoidal excitation field in the vertical direction. We later do it in the horizontal direction and in the depth direction. And then we could find the deformation tensor. So it was very basic biomechanics. And if you depict all kinds of properties of the deformation tensor, you see that we have here the area where the infarct area is, but without radiation, without contrast media, completely non-invasive. All this was done by Mathematica, and it has been many times said before. This was highly promoted also by Marcus van Almsick, who actually, when I was coming to this group here, I said from the beginning, I want to have what Eindhoven is really strong at. I want to have design software. I'm biomedical engineering. I'm not a computer scientist. I need to actually, when a paper comes in, the same afternoon, my students should have the thing programmed. So I need a very high-level program, and Mathematica was exactly that. It's the highest level that exists. You can almost speak English to it, and that means you can do an incredibly fast design. That was my big motivation. It is as complete as you can think. It has all the symbolics, it has all the numerics, and I finally wrote a whole book in this field, front-end vision and multi-scale image analysis. And actually, this was the first fully interactive book. Every code that I discussed was right there. so people could move in their own images and do everything, see it in 3D. It was a completely interactive book, and we use this a lot in many of our applications. And my big love, you all know, was teaching, and we did physics of medical imaging, bioelectricity, medical image analysis, but the big thing was front-end vision. And you see lots of sessions. Actually, the last one is currently going on. Last week, I gave a whole lecture, a full-time, full-week lecture to this group, 40 students and many PhD students. They stay in a hotel in Eindhoven. And next week, I will have my second week, and it will be a pleasure. And it was always great joy and fun to do that. With students anyway, we had the European Congress of Radiology, and Professor van Waas in Utrecht, my leading radiologist, he was frequently visiting the European Congress of Radiology. That's the second largest meeting in the world, the largest meeting in Europe. It's for radiologists. And there are 20,000 radiologists. It's a spectacular meeting. There's not only in 20 rooms parallel sessions, but you also have a major industrial exhibit where more than 200 companies go there. Philips goes there with 250 people. And you have Toshiba, Siemens, you name it. This is a fascinating world where you see how the medical imaging area is. And Professor van Waas introduced me to this team, and they, because I said there is not so much computer vision, so he took me to the organization, and we finally managed that we could set up what's called the Golden Mile, the computer vision exhibit. And every year, I had the honor to pick the best 10 to 14 groups in Europe and discuss with them, have an exhibit for the radiologists in Europe, and that is still ongoing. It was really nice. I was part of the program planning committee. That was really an honor. We were 21 people in this major event. I took care of the computer vision, and 2-3 times a year I flew to Vienna to organize this major event. And then later in Eindhoven I realized all my students should see this. Let's get arranged that they could go there for free. And indeed we arranged a cheap flight and a cheap hostel. And every year I went with 25 people to the ECR, and at the end we had a major party. They dressed up very nicely. They were introduced to this amazing field of imaging, and this was always a fantastic way to get the people involved in, look what a big world you are in, and your career can be right here. We also had social events. We did this in the Ardennes, and every year I took my whole team, about 25 years, and we went hiking for a weekend. I know all groups do that, but we had something special. I invited everyone to talk 5 minutes after the major dinner about the other side of yourself, about your hobbies, your big love. And so we sat down, bottle of wine, beamer on the wall, and we had these fantastic stories with everybody else. And it was heartwarming because the day after we said, hey, I never knew that you were such a good painter. And it made the people get together. It was really nice. Let's get to the science. And I was very happy to get Anna Villanova on board. Anna was instrumental in another wish I had. I said in the beginning, I should do very proper mathematics and physics. I should also do very proper visualization. Anna had a cum laude from Vienna University, from the Meister, Professor Grüller, one of the top leaders in this visualization field. And she was looking for a job in Eindhoven, and I was looking for a visualization expert. It was a wonderful mix. Anna stayed for many, many years. She's now with Eindhoven, with Delft University. This is one of the examples. We have many examples. This is 4D MRI. So you can measure the MRI as a function of time. So we have X, Y, Z, and time. That's four-dimensional. And you see here the particle flow. There are many ways to visualize this flow. You can also flow it. Roy van Pelt was doing this work. But we could now, for the first time, see how well are the heart valves closing? What is actually happening in narrowings, in stenosis of these curved big arches and so on? So a whole new field of patterns emerges. And we did this together with Philips and major hospitals that Philips has access to. as TUE, we didn't have so many access to hospitals, but through Philips, we came in the best hospitals in the world. We did scientific visualization also together with Philips, and here you see some nice work on we did with collaboration with KU Leuven, with Danny Ruiters, who is now head of the IXR group in Philips. He did a PhD, and he looked at, let's say, the visualization of what happens if you have, during the treatment, interventional treatment. Intervention treatment means anything that you can do through a small hole inside a patient. So you go in with a catheter, you blow up a balloon called a dot ring, or you measure temperature, or you do something else. And he visualized this and built a fantastic workstation. Back to the brain. We can image the brain at many, many ways. This is the MRI anatomy. It's actually the brain of Professor Bertolt Wein here present in this room. This is slice by slice measurements on the quarter of millimeter resolution today. We can also measure the function. What does it mean, the function? Functional MRI. Suppose I do this, then I use my motor neurons, who are located more or less here in the center. They use oxygen, they need sugars. So these active neurons, they are making action potentials. They actually say to the environment, please open capillaries and bring more oxygen. Well, oxygen is a paramagnetic substance, and you can actually measure it with MRI. So if you look, for example, to a checkerboard, you see that this area is now active, and you see what an amazing area, how large the visual system is in the back. But now we can see the function. We can see where you think. We even have optical methods, and this is called voltage-sensitive dyes. It's a kind of a pasta that you put on the top of a brain, and if an action potential of a cell gives a high potential locally there, it gives a very tiny light blue light flash. So you can actually see optically the firing of single neurons of the cortex. Well, that is spectacular. Another spectacular development is optogenetics. This is the molecule that we have in our rods and cones. It's called rhodopsin. It goes 7 times up and down, and we have billions of these rhodopsin molecules in different discs in every rod and cone. If a photon hits, this guy opens, and this is a small ion flux. And that's actually giving the result that we see. Well, they found the DNA code of this molecule, built it in the virus, and put this virus in the mouse brain. And the virus said, okay, I'm going to inject my DNA into the cell. The cell put this DNA through its ribosomes and going to make rhodopsin. So the cell becomes light sensitive. So now you can make a mouse, and you can stimulate his brain. This is a tiny movie, and now the light is off, but now with a fiber, they turn on the light, it's located on the motor cortex, and the mouse starts running. And if you turn off the mouse, turn off the light, you turn off the walking of the mouse. So we have some spectacular ways to actually stimulate one by one neurons, or 10 by 10, or 100. They made two variations. With blue light, you excite, and with yellow light, you inhibit neurons. And we have connectivity. We saw the wonderful presentation of Vesna Perskovska, who set up this wonderful company. But with Anna's group, we did a lot of visualizations on finding the fibers in the brain. Those who are at the symposium already saw how it's worked. For those who are not, I repeat a little bit. With an MRI, since about 10 years or so, you can measure the tiny molecules, the motion of water molecules. And if water is just in water, then it moves all the different directions. So if you study it for some time, you see a kind of a spherical cloud. But if water is in a nerve fiber, it can only move in this direction, not so much in this direction. So if you look for some time, then it becomes an ellipsoid. And we can measure with an MRI in every pixel this ellipsoid, measure the long axis, and then if you connect all these axes, you find the wires in the brain. And if it is in, for example, here, in this area, there is no ellipsoid. That means there is no direction right there. So then you can make workstations and finds all these fantastic connections. And I was happy to invite in the team. I was part of the Holst Medal organization team, and in 2010 we invited Professor Le Bihan. He was the inventor of this, what's called diffusion tensor imaging, and it was a great honor to have him. And Anna, with her group, she said, I need to visualize all this. You see to the lower left these images, but these are complex images. We have scalar images, just numbers. We have vector images, like wind field, but these are tensor images. So we have a tensor in every voxel, a 3x3 tensor. And the eigenvectors of the voxel, of the tensor, are the axis of the ellipsoid. So how do you visualize that? Anna took that chance with her team, and she visualized fantastically all these visualizations. And what you see here is the connections between the left and the right brain. It's color-coded. So X, Y, Z is red, green, blue. And you can now, in very fine detail, and Vesna showed that she made a company now out of this. I'm very, very proud of that. She has an e-cloud service where hospitals can upload the 3D data sets. She's doing the visualization, she's doing the connectivity. And today we are discovering that many, many diseases are network diseases. So we look at the brain in a completely different way that epilepsy, Alzheimer, they have connections that are not like standard connections. You have, of course, you have hubs and you have different network topologies. And we can now visualize and quantify these topologies. We use them in many medical applications. And I show you a couple. The first one was, we were asked by the neurosurgeons in Maastricht to assist us in the treatment of Parkinson's disease by deep brain stimulation. And Parkinson patients, they have sometimes this, what's called an attack. They have a lot of tremor. And what happens is very deep in the brain, there's a very tiny nucleus. It's called the subthalamic nucleus. It's about the size of a peanut, and it receives inhibition. But if you get older, the substantia nigra that is around it is deteriorating, and then the inhibition to the cell is disappearing. So the cells go hayward. They fire and they fire, so the patient gets these excitement. And what have they discovered? That if you put a needle in there and you stimulate this with about 5 kilohertz, you can bring about inhibition, and this cell stops firing, this group of cells. So they have to make a pacemaker, put it in here, and during the whole rest of his life, you stimulate this, and the patient is trouble-free. But there was a big problem. You had to stick only in this area and not next door, because if you stick here, you get all kinds of other things, personality changes or depression. So how can we find this very tiny motor area of the subthalamic region? Here we see a patient actually having an attack. You see that he has not full control over his hands. He cannot write, he cannot bicycle anymore. It's quite problematic. And to the right, you see the same patient, and now the stimulus in his head is on. And you see that he has now complete control, and for very serious diabetes patients, for very serious Parkinson patients, this is actually life-saving and gives a high quality of life for many, many years to come. But it's a quite complex operation. It takes about 6 hours. During the operation, the patient is completely awake. During the penetration of the needle, you have to control, are the muscles not getting stiff, etc. But we managed to find very, very detailed the connections here to this subthalamic nucleus. We actually found, and that was worked by Anna Villanova, and Birgit Plantinga, Bram Platel was involved, and we have the super direct highway here from the STN going directly to the cortex, because I thought it should be super not to bring in the needle, but to stimulate the cortex directly. Then you go immediately into the motor area, and indeed we found this hyperdirect pathway. We mapped the three dimensions, the three areas of the subthalamic nucleus actually very nicely. And one thing was nice, there was a 7 Tesla in Maastricht. Maastricht acquired a lot of funding. They got 2 ERC grants. Then the hospital said, or the university, okay, we match these grants. then the province said, we match again. So finally, they had 30 million euros. They had 3 Tesla, 7 Tesla still, and 9.4 Tesla. Well, I could scan on this 7 Tesla with my PhD student. This was Birgit. But it was expensive. You need to pay 1,000 euros per hour for a scan. But the university, I could get a good grant, and we got many hours of scanning. This specimen was taken from a Parkinson patient, and we took it in 7 Tesla for 42 hours, and we could fantastically measure the connections now for the first time to this area. It gave us a much better position of the needle after that, and we also got the connection through, we got funding by NWO in a China-Netherlands program, and we collaborated with the largest brain group in Beijing in the Academy of Science. I'm visiting professor there with Professor Chan Zhejiang. He was the organizer of the MIKAI conference in Beijing, and I frequently come there. And they do the biggest atlas in brain imaging in very tiny detail. It's called BrainNetome, and we got a grant together. Another project is blindness prevention in epilepsy surgery. Sometimes you have epilepsy, and that means a part of the brain is, actually in a kind of, like a microphone is singing around, you get this round loop in the brain. It's very much excited, and if medicine doesn't help anymore, you sometimes have to decide to remove the epileptic focus. And if the epileptic focus is on the side, you have a problem, because on the side, you have the fibers of the vision system, and sometimes in a quarter of the patients, the patient got blind after this operation. So they asked us for help. You can now visualize these. Can you make a kind of a treatment planning system that we plan every individual patient? And that was actually built together with the group of Pauli Osterblok. We first did, and Chantal Tax, she did a fantastic, also cum laude, master, and finally with Max Viergever, a beautiful PhD. We did some probabilistic fiber tracking. Probabilistic means that it is not really accurate, so we took some error measures, and now we could actually see this is the visual cortex. From the eye, it goes here to the thalamus, and these areas is what we wanted to find. And now, for the first time, we could see, okay, doctor, you can operate till here and not deeper. And every patient has different, some has superficial, some is very deep, and now we have the situation that nobody's getting blind anymore. So it was a wonderful collaboration with Kempenhagen, which is 10 kilometers from here. And you see the visualization that Stefan Meesters was making on the transparent brain. I now go do a little bit of neuromathematics. And we started about multi-scale, and everybody's always asking, why do you do multi-scale? Why should you in the world make all these different blurred images? But this is what the brain does. This is what our retina does. We have about 120 retinas, all giving different resolutions. So we send this stack to the brain. But actually, if you see what happens in an image, if you blur it, suppose you have an image here with maxima and minima and saddle points. If you blur it, you get less and less of those. And if you completely blur, you have only one maximum less. It turns out that maxima and maxima, they get together, and they melt together in a kind of top point. But these top points give something very special. They give a tree structure of your image. So you get the hierarchical decomposition of your image actually for free. So all the pixels that are together and form, let's say, an eye, they are one branch of the tree, and this is the mouth. So we see the hierarchical decomposition back in this, what's called the deep structure of an image. Luc Florac was promoting this when we started in Utrecht, and we got a big grant. We had a couple of PhD students, Bram Platel here in the room, Frans Kantes, Evgenia, all here. I'll show you just one small example that we did. They said together, well, if you want to find some subscene, suppose you want to find the kidneys in the nemus, and here we found a thesis. This thesis is somewhere here, but it is, hidden, different rotation. What we could do, find all the top points from the small image and the big image, find the rotation, and then we very nicely could find all these points using these top points. And later on, now we do deep learning, we see, hey, this was actually quite related. We have now these very famous points in computer vision. They're called shift of a scale invariant feature transform. These are quite famous. And if I look now into what modern science is doing, this is a cell in the retina that's recently discovered as a very important cell. It's called a stellate emacrine cell. It was actually unknown what this cell was doing because we couldn't see it very well. But a couple of years ago, they did what's called block phase electron microscopy. With a nanometer scale, they measured these cells. But we also had the function of these cells because of the optical methods, so we could see what the cell is doing. And these were 15,000 slices, and they were manually segmented by hand. Well, how do you do that? We can only do this today. So they put it on the internet, and they said, well, people help us. And they found 1,000 volunteers who manually segmented these 15,000 slices. It's called crowd annotation. It was a Nature paper. We have 100 million of these cells, and these cells measure gradients on the end. And now, in computer vision, it's very famous to measure in a cell the histogram of oriented gradients. This paper was cited about 20,000 times because it is so amazingly effective. It turns out the visual system doesn't look at pixels, doesn't look at intensity, but looks at little stars of orientations. And they're far more effective in matching things. And we have 100 million of these cells. And what we are now going to do is, of course, measure those cells. It's extremely effective in detecting all kinds of things. Let's go a level deeper. If you measure on the brain a mouse that you show different orientations, you see this on the brain, noise. Well, it looks like noise. When they look a little bit more careful, they saw that actually it is rotating in small little islands, and they call these islands hypercolumns. You see the green bar here, and then it rotates this. And it turns out that the brain is extremely well organized. The brain is organized in all kinds of small areas. This area is about a quarter by a quarter millimeter. And all these areas, they form nice bands. And all the, it's like a pinwheel, spokes. This is about 100,000 cells. Every cell along the spoke has a different, is a filter in a different orientation. We have all these different orientations here, extremely nicely organized. This is the complete computer for one pixel, measuring all orientations and also all scales. The largest scale is in the center, and it gets smaller when you go out. So we have an incredibly detailed structure here. So we have these cortical hypercolumns. Of course, we started to model all this, and Remco Duits became an expert in this with his whole team. We had these oriented filters. You get the output here. It's called an orientation score or orientation space. And now we have in one place separation of different orientations. And here you can take your cigar filter, etc. And now we could do some very nice applications. This was from the tissue engineering group of Professor Bayens and Professor Baute. And it was done with a laser. It was noisy. But nicely, we could now enhance the tissue because crossings were no problem anymore. It was quite mathematical. We went to high dimensions. So we have X, Y, Z. We have the dimension of scale. We have the dimension of orientation. That's, again, more orientation. So we did a lot of mathematics. I made a world cloud of the thesis of Marcus van Omsic. And you see lots of things like curvature, differential, all things. This is Erik Beckers, my last cum laude PhD, Subriemannian, a lot of technology. And what did it lead to? In all these measurements that we did with the ellipsoids, it turned out to be too simple to be an ellipsoid. If you have a crossing of fibers, it will not be an ellipsoid. So we said, okay, let's do with the MRI, that was not invented with us, but with someone else, let's do in an incredible amount of directions, measure the probability of the diffusion of water. So we got, instead of ellipsoids, we got these sea stars plus and all different kinds. It's called high angular resolution diffusion imaging. And this is the whole diffusion tensor imaging group. around Remco Duits for the mathematics, Marcus van Almsick, Vesna now, fantastic, and Paolo, both CEO of this company. But Remco managed to get this very noisy stuff also cleaned up. And we were actually one of the first who could actually nicely clean this up by designing diffusion methods in all these different orientations. And these were now the five-dimensional filters, 3 in space and 2 in orientation. And these filters did the nice cleaning up. But it was, of course, a lot of mathematics, not easy to tell you here. This is a page of the thesis of Erik Beckers, and we have many of these pages. But actually, I can say we are among the world players in tractography. It's really nice. I'm very proud of, if I see with the people that we collaborate with at Harvard University, at INRIA, it is top of the line. All these elongated structures were actually also used in finding vessels. And as you know, I have spent quite some time in China. It had a reason. I had a major accident in my left eye, through which I left some vision here. And I said, okay, let's reduce my activities a little bit and focus more on a specific project. But this project actually became quite big. We have our sister school in Shenyang. It's in the upper north of China. And they were doing biomedical engineering. And they have a huge problem in China, and that's diabetes. 11.6% has diabetes, and they were asking, can we detect those people very early? Can we set up a screening program? Well, we have quite some data. We have 24 million people to scan. Can TUE help us to make automated programs for that? And we had just all our detection for elongated structures like FESA and said, okay, we can go for the channels. We got a very nice funding from NWO. We had a company, Ioptics, joining. And what we did is, with cameras, made a measure of the eye. Because what happens, this is a normal person, if you have diabetes, your blood vessels begin to leak. So we have to look for very early leakages. And finally, you get things like this. But if you go to the doctor with this, you're far too late. We want to find people really early. So we set up this screening program, and we call this Retina Check. It's in the upper north. This is the city where the major company Neusoft is located. Professor Kang is here. He was manager at Neusoft, but became the dean of this school, and we became good friends. He's now here today, gave a lecture at the symposium. And he became the first dean of this school. And we started, of course, to collaborate. We have a 20-year collaboration with this school. Professor Hilbers and I have visited many times. And of course, they came to me, Bart, we do imaging there. Can you assist in setting things up? And I went there, and actually I found that it was a booming environment for setting up this big screening project. And this is Professor Ge. He's leading 12 hospitals in ophthalmology. And he is the patient deliverer, and we are the technology deliverer. We signed a contract here. This is Minister Bussemakers. Here we have a whole discussion with Minister Schippers. We got some really nice funding. And we set up a whole acquisition environment. This is the room we have in the diabetes department. We scan more than 4,000 patients here with all the data about blood samples, body weight, lifestyle, interviews. And we scanned in 40 shops where Professor Geur is selling glasses. He put cameras, and we have done over 60,000 normals now. And what did we do? Completely automatic extraction. So we have tracking of fibers. We have finding crossings, bifurcations. We have an extremely detailed measurement of the vessel width in microns. This is active shape modeling. This is a very tiny bleeding, a microaneurysm, and we can find it fully automatic. This is curvature. So we measure if blood vessels get weak, they get more sloppy. And normally, vessels have to be straight to the target, so they have no curvature, they're zero curvature. But if they get sloppy, you measure the histogram, and the size of this histogram is indicated for the state of the disease. We could measure, even if there were missing parts, we could fill the whole gap. And of course, today we do deep learning. Samane Abbasi, she will get her PhD next Monday. That's quite nice. She did a whole neural network. It's a residual network, And we can now completely automatically detect, in this case, exudates, but also microaneurysms. We have a workstation design, and it's actually quite nice. Professor Meyer said, I have two patents. Well, since last week, we have three patents, because we have just patented a very nice way for really nice, fast network training, how we go from level one to level three. Well, this project we now make into a startup, where we collaborate with the Chinese hospitals to collect the images. We hope, of course, to finally even collect the images on a smartphone, that we have really millions of images, put them into a big network. So we're talking to big network providers among Neusoft. And then we have our deep learning software that's doing a pay-per-view. And it's called the... it's a collaboration. We have a support by a startup company in Amsterdam. And it's really vision for health. I need my mouse. So I want to go a little bit into deeper. I see I have to speed up a little bit. I need to, not too long anymore, but this is all new. If we do deep learning, we have all these synapses measured in a network, and this is the network. What happens actually in these layers? I talked about this layer here for the simple ones. So we have brain-inspired computing, but we also have AI-inspired physiology. They can learn from each other. And the first thing I realized that people, we have in the beginning of our eye, these center surround cells, they look like this. Until today, we don't really understand what these cells are doing. They talk about lateral inhibition, surround suppression, but I think they do just local mean subtraction. And we get this data set and we study the variation about the mean, and that's principal component analysis. Because if you do the covariance matrix, you measure here, actually, the subtraction of the mean, and that's what these cells do. And that's one of the discoveries I want to expand further. We have 50% positive and 50% negative. And why do we have that? Well, at first, see some principal component analysis. You take some small areas from what the monkey has seen millions of years ago, what did he develop? And perfectly, we see these first, second, etc., all these derivatives coming up. But if you learn the monkey something else, only vertical bars, what do you get? You get only horizontal derivatives. So if the data are restricted, the filters are restricted, that's exactly what deep learning is doing. So the lesson is no handcrafted filters anymore, but the filters are in the data. We got exactly the right ones. And I think these are the Gaussian derivatives. It's nothing else than the infinitesimal generator of translation. You find nicely Lie group. Remco Duits is now doing a major Lie group analysis, got an ERC grant. It's a Taylor expansion of the local thing. And this proves it a little bit. We see in the dark a cat that was raised for 3 months in the dark, and this cat could only see horizontal lines for 3 hours a day for the first 3 months of his life. So he only saw horizontal lines. So after 3 months, they let the cat see a horizontal stick, and of course, he could nicely see it. But when there was a vertical stick, he couldn't see it because he never developed in his brain the learning of vertical receptive fields. So the lessons is here, it never learned filters for vertical lines. They were not in the data. Of course, the cat went home and learned later on after these things. And the next image, this image you have seen many, many times. It was how to detect faces. It was in my inaugural lecture. And I showed you this is computer-aided diagnosis. We help, but now, several years later, we have this. We see the picture upside down. And now what happens? Can you find the faces? No, you cannot. Because in your brain, you did not develop detectors for faces because faces upside down don't exist. It's exactly like the cat. So even if I give you the faces, you just don't see them. So it's exactly a proof of what this deep learning is doing. So we have now this patent. We can now go. You see here we have the edges, here we see the noses and so on, and we can now nicely find these noses. I want to end with a couple of conjectures. First of all, We have discovered in the retina that we have on and off layers, and nobody knows what these on and off layers are doing. They are the layers right here, and they form two lines to the brain. And they found with this electron microscopy how it is exactly organized, and I think that these on and off layers are subtracted from each other, but with a time delay, and I think that we measure our visual world like this. We only look at differences. And this is completely new. It's the first time I tell this to an audience. And this has not been discovered before. And I just published this actually last week. It is quite spectacular. This is the paper, the on and off pathways. This saves energy. And why do we save energy? Our brain is only using 25 watts with neurons that fire at 6 kilohertz. Well, that's ridiculous. How can this guy measure 25 watts? That means we have an extreme reduction of energy. We should not process all these pixels that are not useful. A data center uses a megawatt, and it has incredible high speed. So if we discover how the brain really works, and we can make this 1 megawatt and so on, this as effective, we can go orders of magnitude much better. This also explains stabilized retinal images. And in the 1970s, when I was in the biophysics field, I did an experiment in the group of Gerrits in Nijmegen, really long time ago. This is more or less forgotten science. There was a lens on my eye, and it was with fibers looking at a screen. And when it is stabilized on your retina, because with the lens it followed my retina, after about 3 seconds, vision completely disappears. So it was very nicely described. If you have a circle moving, you only see the borders, and I think we measure DIDT, and it is kind of amazing. This is what I saw. I saw a green field with a red box on it, and after some time, the box just disappears. There's a filling in, and as long as the box moves, it's there. And if it doesn't move, even the green goes away. So this is actually what we see. This is why you don't feel your clothes anymore, because we have the same receptive fields in all your sensory things. When they changed it, it was a red field with a green square. The green square disappears, but it is filled in. So you can move it around. But again, if you have this red screen, leave it for some time, color disappears completely. Well, we use this a lot in, not a lot, but here you see a filling in effect that we do. It's called in painting. And I happen to know the group of Guillermo Shapiro who invented this. And this in painting, let's show this again. Sorry. You see that the blood vessels are disappearing and we can now nicely in paint them. And you can learn a lot from computer vision in real vision. This is a movie that was made. It's called Slam. I'll move the movie a little bit forward. He has a LIDAR detector, that is a laser detector finding ranges, and he's walking around, and with his computer, he is now, oh, I can't fill it up, he's walking around, and while he walks around, he updates his internal representation by only looking at differences. So I think we only look at differences and we update our internal representation. It's a very effective way of filling the world. They do this with a lot of Lie group analysis, and I think this shows the missing link between fantastic computer science that we do and fantastic biological science that we do. But these worlds are relatively separate. There's another example. In human vision, they found that the color cells, and here we have the band for the left eye, for the right eye, the left eye, you see the pinwheels, the color cells are only in the middle. A very few cells. Why do we have so very few cells for color processing? Well, in the computer science, we already know for some time that Levin, in 2014, he did an experiment. He said, well, I only have the intensity, but I just do the, I give a little bit of colors here on the side, and then I let the color spread out, and he got exactly this. This is called colorization. And I think that our visual system is doing colorization, and it can be extremely effective. You don't need all these cells. We don't need to process every pixel 3 times RGB. There are many more effective things, and this is the lesson I want to give in this lecture, more or less. There's so much to learn from the brain to make our deep learning, which is still in the beginning, far more effective. We have things like superpixels. So we, in computer vision, we know now how to make these. It's done by spectral clustering, very nice PCA techniques on affinity matrices, and you can find now these superpixels. And this is what a monkey should see. If a monkey needs to find in a sunny area or in a shaded area, in both times needs to find the fruit, well, we have now white balancing per superpixel. So this blue and that blue is exactly the same, but you see there's quite some difference here. Our brain makes that difference because we have this adaptivity. And I go to the last one. It's also a conjecture. We only see sharp in the middle, in the fovea. And why is that? Why we have such a special camera? I ask you to look at this guy, and you see a point, but you only see one. Now look at this one. Hey, this one here too. You only see one. So many are there. There are actually quite a few. There are 12. And what happens? In the center, we have very small ones, and this is eccentricity. You get bigger and bigger ones. And in the group in Nijmegen, they have now done very nice work in non-uniformly sampled patches, the same as the fovea, in the middle, very sharp. And they outperform the way that people do. So it's very effective. And I think that it is also effective in designing ego motion. And this is my last slide, my conclusions. Computer-aided diagnosis, it finally works. It is really fantastic, but also just begun. And I have hoped to show you that we can still learn a lot, very much from vision. And the other way around, vision can benefit a lot from computer vision, adaptive from artificial intelligence. We have all these things that are required. We have big data, we have GPU power, we have clever algorithms, but here there's a lot to learn from the biologist, and the biologist can learn a lot from us. So healthcare needs to make all these data available. It will be a lot of struggle. It will take maybe some decades to go. New laws for CAD. We have a lot of success stories in deep learning, but it's actually still a lot of the same. People download TensorFlow from Google, it's for free, and everybody doing the same TensorFlow. So we need more innovation there. And I think brain science and Lie Group Vision, there's many things. And this is the title of my talk, Vision for Health. The patient and the doctor, they benefit. And now I come to my thanks slice, and it's very difficult to thank everyone. But I want to thank Eindhoven University for the fantastic opportunity I got here. The board, in the confidence that I could be professor here, stimulates so many people. It's amazing to see how many of you are doing now the profession that I loved so much, that you do it now and so well. It was shown in the symposium today. I want to express my sincere thanks to Professor Jan Jansen, who invited me as the first rector to come, to the current rector, Professor Bayens, and all my colleague professors, to Professor Hilbers, my colleague professor, who was for many, many years my roommate in our department, my laboratory mate. We had a lot of years together. Rob de Bey, the manager, financial manager, and they all supported me fantastically. My colleagues, my secretary, Rina, it is too much to mention. I have an amazing amount of warm people I worked with, but the most of all, my students, all my students who turned into PhD students, who turned into postdoc, they were a fantastic adventure to work with. We had fun, we had deep discussions, we had excitement, we had discoveries, we had lots of publications together, we had these struggles. It was an amazing time to be professor. I hope to stay a little bit on board. You see on these discoveries that I have some publications to come. I want to write a next book over the couple of years. I discussed with Hetty that I'm allowed to. there is a book written on multi-scale in Mathematica, and of course I want to do a next book over what we did the last year. And with Hetty, I like to thank, because she is the girl that is with me in all my travels. And the way we look here, this is somewhere in southern Jordan. We have a great life in all our adventures that we do together, wherever in the world and in life. I love you. Thank you very much. I have said.